Hey, I'm Mr. True. In this video, we're going to be talking about finding extrema on a graph using calculus techniques, relative maxes or absolute maxes, and mins. But before we get to some examples, let's make sure we understand the definitions. Let f be defined on an interval I containing c. F of c is the minimum of f on I, this interval, and it could just be a part of the x-axis. If f of c, remember this is function notation, we get y values out of a function, so our y value at c is lower than all of the other y values, either in the entire graph or just that neighborhood. For all x in that, you know, interval I, that's what I'm talking about, where we could be talking about the interval containing the whole x-axis or just a portion of it. So here we have a sketch of a graph, and it's closed on the left, open on the right. We're going to talk about that as we get to the last definition here. And the graph rises up. There's a maximum value here. The graph rises up and then peaks at 1.4 and then starts to fall. Now, we'll discuss in a second if this is an absolute maximum or a relative maximum, but it is within this neighborhood and a relative maximum. That definition will come up in the next screen of notes. And we have a relative minimum. So I'm talking about a c value. And f of c, this point right here, is c comma f of c. That y value is lower than all other y values, either in its neighborhood or actually for this graph, every other y value that's contained here. So that would be an absolute minimum. And f of c is the maximum of f on some interval I, if f of c, that y value with that particular c value, maybe this is c sub 1 and here is c sub 2, that's a relative maximum here. F of c is greater than or equal to f of x for all x in that interval. Now the extreme value theorem. If f is continuous on a closed interval, now this is not a closed interval, this is, let's put some marks on here, I should have finished my diagram. Here we have a, and here we have at an x value of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we have b. So this graph is defined from a to b. So it's closed on the left and open on the right. If f is continuous on a closed interval, we'll talk about that in a second, then f has both a minimum and a maximum value. It's guaranteed. You don't get that guarantee when it's an open interval. So let's look at our picture here and, you know, discuss this extreme value theorem. This graph being closed on the left and open on the right, of course, does not fit this definition. It is closed on the left because of the closed dot. We actually are including the x value of negative 1. We have a relative maximum of 4 at 1. We have a relative and actually an absolute minimum at 3, 1. And then it goes up. Now, while this graph has a relative maximum, it does not have an absolute maximum, and that is because, what do we have this going here? This is at 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we are not actually including the y value of 6. It's an open dot. So that y value might be approaching, you might go, well, that y value is 5.9. Well, 5.99 is greater than 5.9. And then you go, okay, well then 5.99 is the maximum value. Well, 5.999 is even bigger, and 5.9999 is even bigger. And I can get infinitely close to that y value of 6 limits, remember those? But we can't actually approach 6, so we can just continue to get incrementally closer and closer, infinitely close to a y value of 6, but not ever actually obtain that value. We can always get a little bit closer. So that is why it says, you know, you are guaranteed an absolute or guaranteed a maximum and a minimum on a closed interval. See, now if I come in here and I fill in that dot, then I have a minimum again of 1 at the x value of 3, and I have an absolute maximum at a maximum value of 5 at an x value of 6. So for this extreme value theorem, you do need that closed interval idea because of, you know, us being able to infinitely approach that value and thus always being able to get a little bit larger and a little bit larger and a little bit larger and so on. Let's make sure that we understand the definitions of relative max and mins. I'll just write the definition up. I kind of already verbally talked about it. And then we'll go into some examples. Woo! So we have our definition of relative max and min. If there's an open interval containing C, that's the round parentheses, where we had, like, say, the open dot, which I then closed. Where are we at? If we have a, if there's an open interval containing C on which f of C is a maximum, then f of C is called a relative maximum. If there is an open interval containing C on which f of C is a minimum, then f of C is called a relative minimum. What is that supposed to mean? Well, in our graph here, we have an absolute minimum, like I say, but we, if I say within this neighborhood, maybe from 2 to 4, what is the relative minimum? Well, that's going to be 1 at the x value 3. It's like on your graphing calculator where you find maximum values graphically, you have to tell what's the lower and the upper bound. What's the neighborhood where you want to find this relative max or min? We have a maximum here, again, of 4 at 1, and we have another max here. This is the absolute max for the entire graph, but within this neighborhood, we have a maximum here. Now, if I were to add some to this picture, but I think they'll be sloppy, so let me just do this. If our function were to, say, look like this, rise up, peak, come down, rise up again, and then fall indefinitely, so our open interval is the entire, you know, x-axis, our interval is from negative infinity to positive infinity, with the arrows going down forever, then this graph does not have an absolute minimum. It's falling forever, unless you want to call that negative infinity, but we're not going to be doing that. But within this open interval here, there is a value which gives us the largest possible y value. Within this neighborhood here, we have a relative minimum, and within this neighborhood here, we have another relative maximum, and actually for this entire graph, whatever that y value would be there, that would be the absolute maximum, this would be the relative minimum, the relative maximum, and here we have a relative minimum. So, we're going to be taking a look at finding guidelines, or I'm going to give you the guidelines for finding extrema, and then walk through some examples right now. Woo! Here are steps. Find the critical numbers of f in this open interval of a to b. Remember that your critical values are where your derivative, your first derivative, is equal to 0, or your derivative, your first derivative, is undefined. We need that undefined part because, remember, we cannot find the derivative at a sharp bend, as an example. So if we have an absolute a graph that involves an absolute value function, we can't find the derivative at a sharp bend. So where that derivative would just be equal to 0, in this case that would be, you know, whatever this x value is, that's not necessarily all of our critical values. So remember that. And then evaluate f, this function, the original function, at each of the critical numbers. And the order is not really that important. And at the endpoints, if your interval is closed. Then all you're going to do is just look down your list of answers, the largest y value that you get from, again, testing all your critical values and the endpoints of your closed interval, if it happens to be. Well, the largest y value will give you or show you where and what the maximum value is, and the smallest answer will tell you where the minimum is. So, with our first example here, we're not going to find any relative maxes or mins. I just want to talk about finding the critical value. So we have y equals 2x plus 8 over x squared. We're going to find the derivative of this, but before we do that, to find the critical values, I want to rewrite this so that it is not a quotient and have it as 2x plus 8 times x to the negative second power. Now that means that y prime, or the derivative of y, is going to be equal to, with respect to x, is going to be equal to 2. Negative 2 down here, we'll get negative 16x to the negative third power. And that, of course, becomes 2 minus 16 over x to the third. Now, I want to find out where this first derivative is equal to zero, and if it's undefined anywhere, that's also going to be a critical value. So let's find out where the first derivative is equal to zero. So that's going to be 0 is equal to 2 minus 16 over x cubed. We're going to move the 16 over x cubed with addition over to the left-hand side. Get 16 over x cubed equals 2. Multiply both sides by the x cubed and get 16 equals 2x cubed. Divide both sides by 2 and we get 8 is equal to x cubed. And then when we get rid of that power of 3 by cube rooting both sides, we get the final answer of x equals 2. Now, remember when you take the odd root of a number, you don't need to say that there's a plus and a negative, because that doesn't work. The cube root of 8 is not negative 2. Negative 2 times negative 2 is 4, times another negative 2 is negative 8, which is incorrect. So this function is going to have a slope of 0. That means the first derivative is equal to 0 at an x value of 2, so that would be a critical value. Now, the derivative, the first derivative, as well as the original function, is also undefined at 0. You can't divide by, you can't divide by 0, right? So you're going to take this denominator and set it equal to 0, which of course is going to give you an answer of 0, and the function is undefined at 0. The derivative, the first derivative, is undefined at the x value of 0. So we actually have two critical values here. So I just wanted to bring this up to make sure that you remember that it's not just where the derivative, the first derivative, is equal to 0 that sets up or finds your critical values. Let's do another example. As always, our examples are going to go from easier to hard. So this is just a parabola. We're going to locate the absolute extrema of the function on the closed interval. So we have y equals 3x squared minus 12x, just a basic polynomial. We have the closed interval of 0 to 3. So we're going to find that first derivative, which is going to be 6x minus 12. We're going to find out... You do understand why we're setting the first derivative equal to 0, right? Because that graph is rising up, maybe with a positive, let's see, you're going to be reading left to right, aren't you? So that graph is going to be rising up, reach maybe a maximum, and that slope is going to go from positive to negative. But in the middle, right at the very, very peak there, or the minimum, the bottom, you're going to have a slope of 0. So we're going to take this first derivative, set it equal to 0. And we get 12 equals 6x, and x is equal to 2. That is our critical value. That's the only place we have to worry about testing besides the endpoints of the closed interval. Since this is differentiable everywhere along the x-axis, all real numbers and the original function as well as defined, it's just polynomial. So we're going to now test our endpoints and any critical values we found. So we have y is equal to, or f of x, is equal to 3 times 0 squared minus 12 times 0. That's, of course, going to be equal to 0. We have y is equal to, notice I'm plugging these into the original function, not the first derivative, equals 3 times our first critical value, our only critical value of 2, squared minus 12 times 2. Now, this is going to be 3 times 4, which is 12. 2 times 12 is 24, so minus 24, and we get negative 12. Then we have y is equal to, let's see here, our upper limit of our interval of 3, so we have 3 times 3 squared minus 12 times 3. That's 3 times 9, which is 27. 12 times 3, which is 36, so minus 36, and this is going to give us negative 9, right? Yes. Now, we should have expected, you know, knowing that this is a parabola and our leading coefficient is positive, this parabola is opening up, so we should be expecting where we found our critical value, where the derivative was equal to 0, we should be expecting to find our our absolute minimum in this closed interval, and indeed we did, which was our absolute minimum is negative 12 at an x value of 2. And that was, again, our min value. Our maximum value, our absolute maximum value, is simply where the largest y value is, that's 0. So our max is 0 at x equals 0, and that is, again, both of these are absolute maxes and mins. And that's it. Find the derivative, find your critical values, test them, test each of those critical values along with the endpoints of your closed intervals, and just simply look at your answers for your max and mins. However, of course, we know that the derivatives can become a little bit tougher to do than just a basic parabola. So let's look at those questions that are a little bit harder.
For our next example, we have f of x equals 1 minus x over x squared plus 3. Closed interval, negative 2, 4. We're still finding absolute extrema.
So this derivative, of course, is going to require the use of the quotient rule. So we have f prime of x is equal to the derivative, the denominator, x squared plus 3 times the derivative of the numerator, which is, that's a 0 and this is negative 1, minus the derivative of the denominator now, and that's going to be 2x times the numerator of 1 minus x all over the denominator squared, so x squared plus 3 squared. Okay, let's work on the numerator here. We have the negative 1 to distribute, and we have a negative 2x to distribute. So we have negative x squared minus 3. We have negative 2x times 1 is negative 2x. And negative 2x times negative x is positive 2x squared all over x squared plus 3 squared. Combining like terms, we have negative 1 and 2. So we have x squared minus 2x minus 3. And this is all, of course, our first derivative over x squared plus 3 squared. Now, our critical values are where the derivative, the first derivative, equals 0 and where it's undefined. Now, we have a variable in the denominator, so that means that we most of the time will have an issue with that denominator equaling 0 and thus having an x value where this function is not differentiable or the first derivative is undefined. However, if you take a number and you square it, you get a positive answer. And then that positive answer is getting added by 3, or I guess x squared could also be 0, and then you're going to add by 3. And so if you take a number, no matter whether it's positive or negative, and square it, and then add yet another positive number to it, this denominator is never going to equal 0. So we're just going to look at the numerator. And the numerator, if you have a fraction whose numerator is equal to 0, the entire fraction is equal to 0, thus the first derivative is equal to 0. So x squared minus 2x minus 3 equals 0. This is a factable trinomial. This is x minus 3 times x plus 1. And that means that our derivative is going to be equal to 0 at the x value of 3 and negative 1. Okay, so now we have our, Now we have our two critical values, we have our endpoints. Let's plug those in and find our absolute max and min. And actually, I don't think you need to watch me plug numbers in and calculate values, so let me pause it, shorten up the video a little bit, maybe you can make sure that you get the right answers before I hit play again. Well, here we go. I plugged in the endpoints of negative 2, I got 3/7. I plugged in my first critical value of negative 1 and got 1/2, which ended up being my largest y value, so we have a max of 1/2 at negative 1. I plugged in 3 and 4, and when I plugged in 3 and 4, I got negative 2 over 12 and negative 3 over 19. Now, if you have a calculator, if you're allowed to use a calculator in your class, of course, you can just type these into your calculator and find a decimal version of the answer and pick the smallest one, so I almost said the largest one. But if you're having to do this by hand, of course, you need to have your denominators, when you have fractions this close, You need to make sure that the denominators, you have a common denominator, so you can just look at the numerator to determine which one is larger or smaller. So I multiplied this fraction by 19 on the top and bottom, this one by 12, because 19 is prime, so I didn't have any choice. And I have a numerator of negative 38 and a numerator of negative 36. Of course, negative 38 is more negative, and thus it is the largest, or excuse me, the smallest value. So we have a min value of negative 2 over 6, 12, or negative 1 6, at an x value of 3. Got another example for you. For our last example, we have f of x is equal to 2 minus absolute value of x minus 5 and on the closed interval of 1, 2, 6. Now, we have a linear function inside this absolute value function. It's just x minus 5. So hopefully you recognize that this is just going to be a downward facing V shape. And we also know that absolute value functions or their graphs will have a sharp bend in them. So this is going to have a bit of an issue with finding the derivative. You want to take the absolute value function, take what's inside of it, and this is sort of an easier example, but we have x minus 5, set that equal to 0. What makes the inside of that absolute value function equal to 0, you're going to have a sharp bend there, and thus this function is not going to be differentiable at the x value of 5. So what we're going to do is, we're going to look at this in two pieces. What happens if x is equal to, not equal to, but larger than 5? So if x is greater than 5, then what's inside this absolute value function is going to be positive. So f of x is going to be equal to 2 minus, and then x minus 5, that expression inside the absolute value function is going to give you a positive answer. We can take this negative sign, distribute it, get 2 minus x plus 5, or 7 minus x. Whoops. So f of x is equal to 7 minus x for all values where x is greater than 5, to the right of that sharp bend that we're going to see at 5. Now, the derivative of f of x is going to be equal to simply negative 1. And we're trying to find critical values. So if the derivative is just negative 1, a constant value of negative 1, well, that's never going to equal 0. So there are no critical values to the right of 5. Now, if f is less than 5, then f of x is going to be equal to 2 minus. Now, if I'm trying to take, and I'm checking the absolute value function out of here so I can take the derivative to the left and right of the sharp bend. So what's in here? If I put a value in here that is less than 5, a small number minus 5 is going to be a negative answer. So I'm going to put in a negative parentheses x minus 5. Very similar to when you learn how to solve absolute value functions. You would isolate the absolute value function, then write the equation just the way it sits, and then write the equation again with a set of negative parentheses around that expression that's inside the absolute value function, you know, showing that you can have a positive or negative value inside that absolute value function, and then, you know, of course, if the absolute value function is in there, it's going to eliminate those negatives. So our difference inside could be positive, or our difference inside could be negative, and indeed it will be if x is less than 5. So we have, well, what? We've got a negative times a negative is positive, so now we have 2 plus x minus 5, that's going to be x minus 3, or f of x will be x minus 3, and so f prime of x is going to be equal to 1, which also will never equal 0. So the only critical value, remember, critical values are where the first derivative is equal to 0, or the function is undifferentiable, or the first derivative is undefined. So our only critical value is at that x value of 5. So now, let's just, to keep this tape as short as possible, this video as short as possible, let's pause it. You take these endpoints, plug them in, and the critical value, and see if you can find the absolute max or mins. while I do the same and come back and give you the answers and finish this video. There you go. Plug in 1, you get a y value of negative 2, which ends up being our absolute minimum value. Plug in 5, we get our max value, which should have been expected, that sharp bend, because with this negative in front of the absolute value function, that V-shape is opening down, so the sharp bend should have been our max value. And then at the other end point of 6, we got a y value of 1, which just wasn't small enough to be the absolute min. So, I'm Mr. Tarrou. Go do your homework.